Good afternoon. My name is Chris McNulty. This is about the 13th time I've spoken today, so I won't introduce myself at great length. But today's session, I'm here joined by my colleague, former MVP partner, and good friend, John White. Say hi, John.
Hi, John.
We're going to talk more about what this session is and introduce ourselves in a few minutes. But today's session is really focused on business apps for SharePoint. And so we're going to begin with a demonstration that exercises most of the major components of the business app suite that sits on top of SharePoint. And so that is Power Apps, Flow, and Power BI. So we're going to begin with a scenario that we touched on in the keynote called Secret Shopper. So in the case of Secret Shopper, the hypothesis is Contoso needs to gather information from the field. About buyer behavior in our stores around the world. And so we've used Power Apps tied to a SharePoint list to allow our research team, when they're in the field on a smartphone or tablet, or if they have received other reports and they need to enter them into a SharePoint site, being able to collect all that information in a SharePoint list. From there, we're able to take further processes around it, to write it to an on-premises data warehouse, and then stitch that up with Power BI, and finally reintegrate all of those insights back to where it started inside of SharePoint. So let's take a look at how that all works in practice. So to do this, I am going to start on my iPhone. I'm going to launch my Secret Shopper app. And so here's the app. It gives me a map of locations around North America. We've just begun branching out into the UK and the EU, so we'll have to amend that map momentarily. And it gives me the ability to add new reports. And these reports allow me to inspect human-like behavior, like I could capture this image right here as part of my report, as well as put a title in. We're doing this at Fabricam. And we can capture the name of the location where I am. I have to spell it correctly. Browse for whichever particular product we wanted to grab. Let's assume that we're looking at ladies' dresses. What was the customer action? We could say that they took it off the rack, and it was an item that was available at 39. We're done, and we submit the report. Now, when I submit the report, I'm going to jump over to my demo machine here. Waiting for this to pick up. We're on 3. Look at that. Isn't that wonderful? Can we have a round of applause for our AV team? Thank you. So here we can pick up the report, and all the information that I've captured comes into this list, but it comes in a lot of times in different formats, so we want there to be an approval process. So if I scroll down here to the bottom, you can see the entry I just made. And in addition to writing it to the list, as new entries come into the list, we've triggered a Microsoft Flow process to look for an approval email. And that approval email has sent a note to John as my manager, as well as to me. And so we can jump over here and take a look at what we saw, asking me to put a rating on this. Come on up there. There we go. Let's open up my mail. Doesn't look like my mail. Let's try that again off the waffle. We're getting a little latency on this. We might be able to speed this up a little bit because this went to John as well.
If I got it.
I'm sure you have it. Anyway, we've triggered a process that's going to automatically ask for a rating and an approval. And once that rating and approval are issued inside of email, let's try one more time.
I got it.
So John's able to see that. Receive a button directly in his email. When he approves it, we trigger a process that reaches back into my on-premises data gateway, and through that is able to, oh, there we are. I'm going to get to my email about 2 minutes too late. Through that, we're going to write it into a SQL server that lives on-premises. And we could have chosen to write this to a SharePoint list on-premises. Anything I get to through the gateway, I can treat on-premises as easily as I can address those sources if they happen to live in the cloud. On top of that, we've already built a Power BI report. Oh, there's my mail. Great, just in time. And in my Power BI report, which we called for Secret Shopper, we can see all of the information that's out there. And we will see, by the way, in our run through a few minutes ago, there were only 36 reports. So the new report has come in. This is a live feed. You can now see that the little dot is sized by the number of reports we've received from regions. So definitely, Vienna is an area on the rise. That's great if I'm someone who lives inside of Power BI. But as I mentioned, we want to make sure all that information comes back into the place where it was generated. That means I want to bring that information back inside of SharePoint. So we've already done that for you here. If I come to the home page of my site, using the modern pages here, I've built a page already. Welcome to ESPC. And we can see on this page, in addition to a lovely photo of a tiny parish church I discovered walking around your city on Sunday afternoon, we also have the ability to embed additional reports and visualizations inside of this. So if I come and take a look at what's here, I can edit this page, and I can add the new Power BI web part onto this page. Using the modern parts, if you were in my colleague Mike's session before, we're talking about what you're able to do with the framework. Our modern parts are built using the SharePoint framework. And here I can see the Power BI tool. So once I've selected the Power BI part, I can just jump over here, grab the URL for my report. Paste it onto my page. Edit the properties of the Power BI section. And once I've done that, that report's going to show up here in my modern page, which is great for web users. And also, if I jump back to iPhone, which is where all this started, someone in the field might want to be able to look at trends. We've embedded that inside of the team side experience that we get inside of the SharePoint app. So if I take a look at these pages that are published here, I'm able to get something which, using responsive design, is going to give me visibility into those report elements. And I can see right here, as Power BI continues rendering, I'm able to look at those reports. I can drill in and do more things with them. So what do you think about that? Awesome. So as we go throughout the next hour, we want to walk through many of these elements and many more for how I bring data into repositories that may be on-premises or maybe in the cloud, and then how do I make the user experience of it work most effectively, regardless of where those users need to consume, whether it is on-premises, in the cloud, or on mobile devices. So we're going to take a moment. Why don't you come back out? Looking sure. In the background.
At least you're not below me this time.
No, I'm going to stay on this. We've done this before, but I like to walk out to the audience. But John is a little taller than me, and when I 4 feet down, it becomes really hard to continue the dialogue. So a little bit about me and a little bit about us. I've known John for, gosh, I can't even think of how many years.
Long enough.
But I am a senior product manager at Microsoft, a company I joined a little over a year ago, after having been an MVP for a number of years, working on problems for IT pros and business intelligence. John?
Yeah, my name is John White. I'm a CTO and co-founder of a company called UnlimitedViz out of Canada. I've been an MVP with SharePoint since 2011. I'm also a VTS with Microsoft Canada. And we specialize and always have specialized on BI solutions. In the past, on SharePoint, now with SharePoint.
That's a great way to put it. And John and I have been working on this content for a while. This photo actually dates back to last summer. If you take a look, actually, you can see we're right outside the Visitor Center at Microsoft in Redmond. We're doing our best good cop, bad cop pose. in front of a sweet, sweet, sweet Dodge Challenger, which was loved by everyone on campus all week. Anyway. So we recognize there are definitely some opportunities and definitely some challenges that we tend to hear consistently. We know, based on the usage patterns before, there's a lot of momentum around centralizing data on premises. Microsoft is a cloud-first company, so we definitely hear a lot about my data's on premises, all of your new cool things are in the cloud. The other thing that we hear an awful lot about is mobility. People at executive levels, especially at the C-suite, want to be able to get to data from wherever on any device, and whether that is an intelligent panel in a boardroom, a tablet in an airport, or a smartphone at a child soccer game, she or he always wants to be in touch with the latest and greatest information. And then finally, being able to understand that as I'm connecting to newer services in the cloud, whether they're Microsoft services like Dynamics CRM or Salesforce or Oracle or any of the other things that we know are available out there, we want to make sure that we're integrating that into our reporting and into analytics that we may be using and running on premises. We know these are all challenges, and the great news is that we're finally, after several years of wandering around, able to bring all this information into SharePoint, out of SharePoint, through SharePoint, to using it to reach to users to wherever they need to consume that information. So the demo that we just walked through, just to explain the different moving pieces of it, we began inside PowerApps. PowerApps wrote out live to SharePoint. Then we triggered a Microsoft flow for an email-based approval that wrote it back through the data gateway into an on-premises SQL Server data warehouse. Next phase of that SQL Server is able to reach back. It doesn't reach back. Power BI is able to interrogate that data through the gateway to light it up inside of the cloud. And then using our modern web part, we can take that and embed it into web and mobile experiences for users wherever they are. Now, the truth of the matter is this may not be a realistic world, real-world scenario. There may be places where I might say PowerApps should write directly to SharePoint on-premises, or PowerApps should write directly to Microsoft SQL Server. All of that's possible, but we wanted to make sure that in the initial idea of what's available to you, we were hitting every step in the stack, and you're going to see a lot more complex permutations of this as we go through the next hour. So there are many reasons to decide where information should live and from where it should be consumed. And the two governing factors around all of that, no matter how you slice it, relate to data latency and data sovereignty. Now, it's one set of issues when I'm dealing just with putting documents into SharePoint and where they live around the world, but because there's orchestration sitting behind the scenes for a business intelligence or business app scenario, we need to be mindful about how the data moves between its source to the reporting engine, and then from that visualization engine to the point of consumption. In understanding that, we need to consider the latency factors involved. So if I have a large data warehouse that lives in East Asia and a real-time reporting engine that lives in Europe for a bunch of users in North America, I'm introducing a lot of extra latency I might not need to do. That's one of the things that we can do with Office 365 is help make sure that we're putting the data in places closer to where it's being reported on and or closer to where it's being used, depending on the currency. Obviously, if I have a data source that changes seldom, I can cache that data using some of these techniques. If most of my usage is going to be dynamic, I'm going to want that user hop to be as fast as possible. The other issue is data sovereignty. Again, very complex issue, but understanding where the data is at rest is probably the most important thing, and with the cloud, you can be more flexible at making sure data remains where it's supposed to be. The other guidance here is there are many SharePoint-based workloads which are uniformly distributed between on-premises and cloud, and there are some that, you know, Team Sites is one good example. There are some like the add-in models that you can use in both environments. There are others which are exclusively cloud. When we look at BI, we see a radical shift in the tooling that's available to me between on-premises and cloud. SQL Server is the big tool set that we use for data analysis and storage for on-premises data in most cases, and the ways that we deliver that inside SharePoint, largely the classic tools of SQL Server Reporting Services, Performance Point, and Power Pivot. Power Pivot is essentially the on-ramp that spins us into a discussion about Microsoft's leading cloud tool, Power BI, along with some of the Azure-based themes. And as we look forward at some of the strategic investments Microsoft continues to make, Power BI is going to be the pack horse that leads us forward. As someone who's been working with SQL Server Reporting Services for 10, 15 years or something, I'm really happy that we've been able to really reinvigorate the platform with the release of SQL Server 2016. SSRS has a number of enhancements really designed, we're going to walk you through to help bridge that. The takeaway on this slide, though, is understand that the tooling is fundamentally different between on-premises and cloud, which is where hybrid BI really helps us join those two things. John?
First off, I got to say sorry about the blue background. I'm not sure where that's come from, so I'm going to have as much trouble reading this as you folks are. I'll try to walk you through it. So really, to understand how BI works, if anyone was in my session the other day, they saw a variation of this slide. Which one's next? Green?
Big green arrow.
Fundamental principle of BI is you need to get your data from where it is to a place where you can report upon it. And you do that through a process called extract, transform, and load. You would normally load your data into a data warehouse or a data marts of some sort, or into some sort of a multi-dimensional type model. So the difference, fundamental difference between a data mart and a data warehouse breaks down to its usage and its storage. So if you have, it lines up perfectly with retail, which is where the terms come from, right? If you have a store or a mart, it's usually designed around a specific audience. They get their goods from a warehouse, which is where the original manufacturers ship their goods to, or in our case, data, and then it is tailored for each specific mart. Multi-dimensional storage systems, be they tabular or OLAP, are designed for reporting on data multi-dimensionally, the ability to pivot and see things by different dimensions and different measures. You would typically then query those data sources from either something like a reporting server, in the Microsoft world it's going to be SQL Server, a middleware server like SharePoint can connect to these data sources and pass through to end users, or you would use actual design tools or BI tools themselves like Excel and Power BI and Tableau. By the way, I'm just going to stop here and mention as well, these slides, I just see a few people taking pictures, and that's cool. The deck is actually available, that URL down at the bottom, if you can see it. And you can download those at your leisure.
I'm going to suggest one other thing. If you follow me on Twitter, I should actually probably take this over, but I'm at CMcNulty2000. Let's see if I can do this here. Surprise. Let's use a very quick, sophisticated word processor. At CMcNulty2000. We're still getting this feed. We'll get to it later,
yeah, when we flip back. Power BI and Excel and self-service BI take this approach a little bit differently, it still harkens back to that original BI approach. We have these different data sources, but clicker's not working.
Let's get the clicker working.
Oh, you don't have it in the foreground.
Go for it.
This stage is cursed, isn't it?
We'll have an exorcism. So.
We can still pass the data through an ETL process, but the ETL process in this world is called Power Query. If you've heard of the term Power Query, it's available now in Excel. It forms the core of Power BI Desktop. And that data can be loaded into a data cache, which essentially forms, basically is a data warehouse or and data mart or multi-dimensional storage all rolled into one. It isn't any one of those things specifically. I guess it's closest to a multi-dimensional data store than anything else. But this is all happening on a workstation at design time. We can then deploy our work to the Power BI service in the cloud should we wish to do so. You're messing with me. That says Power BI. The logo's black. We can deploy it out to the Power BI service in the cloud. And that Power BI service is actually backed by that very same data model. So when I say data model, this is the thing I'm talking about. From there, our mobile clients can access the Power BI service and then work on that deployed data model. So the question is, how do we keep that data up to date? If I've performed that extract, transform, and load, I've taken it from its source location, I've loaded it into that data model, I've deployed it out to the service, it's going to be stale. I need to get that up to date. So to start with, we have our Power BI service that our clients are interacting with. As well, by the way, we can deploy a Power BI desktop as well as Excel files, because both of these clients support the same data model. Power BI service works with both of them natively. You're going to keep doing that to me, aren't you?
Yep. If I can't read it from 3 feet away.
Yeah, I know. I'm standing right next to this monitor.
Yep.
I have no idea where this blue comes from. Anyway.
Yep.
On a periodic basis, we have a service in the Power BI service to do updates. And you'd set up the schedule yourself. But it's going to run. And if our original data source was, if our original data source was in the cloud, and that could be coming from SharePoint or Azure database or any number of other sources, that's just going to load right through into our data model following that power query we set up originally in the client. But also, more importantly, I think, if our data is on-prem, we can pass it through the on-prem data gateway, back up to that data model as well. So that's one way to work with the Power BI service. Did you lose focus on me? Okay. There's another technology within Power BI called Direct Query. And if that refresh model isn't fast enough, if we need our data to be fairly up to date, we can use what's called Direct Query. So we start from the same place. Our clients are accessing the Power BI service. But when they're interacting with that deployed data model, it's not really there. It's a virtual data model. We have all of the calculations that we built up, but the data itself still sits in its original location. So every time anyone actually makes a query to the data model, it gets passed back to that source. So again, if it's in the cloud, that gets sent down directly to the service, or if it's on-prem, the gateway reaches back to our original service, be it SQL, be it analysis services, or any one of about 5 other services. I think we see that here in just a moment. In addition, we can use Excel Online to take advantage of the same capability. So we can deploy a direct connected Excel spreadsheet and interact with on-prem data as we want to see fit. These are the sources available. I'll read them out to you. On-prem right now, we support analysis services tabular, analysis services in multidimensional or OLAP mode, traditional cubes, SQL Server, SAP HANA, Oracle, and Teradata, all on-premises through the gateway. That list is growing every month. And in the cloud today, SQL Azure Database, SQL Azure Data Warehouse, and Spark on HD Insight are the supported data sources for direct query. It's a subset of what you can do with the refresh model, but it's a fairly big subset. I want to point out a bit of a caveat when you use direct query specifically on-prem. If you're working against an SSAS backend database, you need to configure your connection with very, very high privileges. When you're connecting to just regular SQL Server or any other data source, you want to use a least privileges account. That's because when you connect to SSAS, the source identity of the user gets passed to the back end, so you get row-level security implemented at SSIS within your organization. And all of the rest of the services will use a proxy authentication at the moment. So if we put it all together, this is what we see. We have the refresh model, and we have the direct query model. This is the architecture of Power BI. We can have one other way right now to get data into the Power BI service, and that's through an API. You can write an application that will pump data directly into one of these data models for you. That completes the picture. So that basically gives you a complete architecture of how the data flows within the Power BI service. That gateway is central to it. And speaking of the gateway,
so just a little bit of setup for some of the plumbing. As I mentioned before, the gateway is the magic that makes it possible for us to treat on-premises data sources as the sisters or brothers of the data sources that we have in the cloud. So the on-premises data gateway, which is the current name for the ARDIS, formerly known as the Power BI data gateway.
And the enterprise data gateway.
And the enterprise data gateway. And the personal data, we won't talk about the personal data gateway. In looking at the ways that we've been approaching Power Apps and Flow, since these are data services that need to write as well as read data, and since we're using a common connection model, the Power BI gateway was a great way of handling this. So if you're already running one of the legacy Power BI gateways, you can install this. What happens once it's installed is it sits on premises and it establishes a secure encrypted tunnel for connectivity between the data sources on premises and the cloud. It intrinsically adds no security to or from those connections. You need to supply the credentials in your definition for how I connect from Power Apps, from Power BI, or Flow down into the on-premises data source. And the gateway brings all of that together into the Azure Service Bus. How this works for Power BI, for Power Apps allows me to, gosh, this is really difficult to read.
I know.
It is white on backgrounds on my screen over here, so sorry about that, folks. So Power Apps gives us a cloud service, and the cloud service consumes all of the connections that I have available to me down here that are brokered through things like the on-premises gateway or direct connections to cloud services. The Power App services lives inside Azure and publishes applications out to there. On top of that, Microsoft Flow gives you the capability to design based on templates that we publish in the service for common data connections like MailChimp, SQL, SharePoint, and so forth, with common steps pre-built for you, and also allows you to step in and create your own. We're going to take a look at those here in demo momentarily. So let me jump back over to the demo system here, which is on line 3. And so just in showing the process of building this, here we are in the list. I already have a Power App for this, but if I wanted to build a new Power App around this, that process looks like this. Create a new app. And it understands where I'm coming from. So I'm going to give this a name, ESPC16. Let's create this Power App. When I say I want to create the Power App, understanding I'm coming out of SharePoint, it's going to preserve my data context, my data connections, and the app that I build is registered and saved back to the SharePoint list as one of the possible views that I can select. And the application template that it's going to build for me is a three-screen application that's going to give me a browse screen for all the data, a view screen for individual records, as well as an edit screen. And then allows me to step in and do custom layouts. So here's what I have, and it's made some selections for me based on that data source. And in most cases, I could step in and change the style and change the color if I wanted to, but in the interest of time, since it's only an hour, we're not going to do that. But if I just click play, this is already a usable application. And when it's time for me to save that application, if I choose to, I could pick a different icon for it.
Pick dark blue.
Let's pick dark, yeah. No. Let's pick light green, something that's a lot more usable. And when it's time for me to save that application, it's going to save it to my tenant. And I have the ability then from inside Power Apps to do more with it. In much the same fashion, if I want to build some automation around those datas, let's take a look, not with this view. Let's go back to my all items view. And you see I have the opportunity to create a flow. And again, if I want to build a new flow against this list, it's going to show me by default, although Flow understands lots of data sources and lots of other templates, in context, these are the things that people tend to do most often inside or outside of SharePoint. So capturing information from tweets into this list, pushing list items into Slack or custom items, marking things as complete. In this case, when a new item is added, we want to send an approval email. And then I can take further actions to push the information from this list back to SQL with this is essentially is the process that we use to build it. And finally, for setting up those gateway services are initially set up and brokered through the website you use to manage this, powerapps.com. This is where I can specify multiple environments, where I may have information that I want to keep in one environment for test purposes, another for production purposes. It's the place where I go to set up a new gateway. So if I need to set up a new gateway, the icon for setting up a new gateway inside of the app is conveniently labeled New Gateway for memory impaired people like myself. So I can pick that, and it's going to open up the screen that allows me to download the new on-premises data gateway. I'm not going to walk through the installation, but this is a largely click-click OK thing. It asks me to log into the place, to the tenant where I'm going to be registering this service. The end of that gives me a list of common gateways, and this was already done. We're flowing through this gateway right now, and I can come here and inspect to see what are the connections that are running through it. We can see that it's tying back to a specific SQL server and a specific database that's out there, that it's on-premises. So I can consume that into other flows and into other Power Apps in just the same way I could consume SQL from Azure. The same things work for SharePoint. It's worth noting you can do this against SharePoint, not just 2016, but 2013, because we want hybrid capabilities to be available to users wherever they are in their SharePoint journey without having to force them through an upgrade cycle.
I think it's also worth pointing out that that's the same gateway that's used for Power BI as Flow,
right,
as apps.
Right, it's all coming through the same environment. So if we come back to our presentation, so let's walk through a couple of the scenarios here, John.
Yeah, I got it. I want to just basically walk through a couple of examples of doing this. And we're going to talk about reporting. These will be reporting cases. And we're going to do a little bit of reporting in the cloud with data on-prem. And then just a few minutes, we're going to walk through the opposite case, reporting on-prem of data that happens to be in the cloud. And before I do so, I just want to articulate what how Microsoft divides out four different report types. In their reporting manifesto of last fall, they laid these four out: paginated, interactive, analytical, and mobile. And what I really want to translate them into, I'm glad it's light gray, paginated reports are those that are built essentially for printing. And if you've used SSRS in the past, these are the classic SSRS-style reports, although the SSRS of today, SQL Server Reporting Services, will do more than just those things. Interactive reports, the way Microsoft defines them, are Power BI reports. Or if you've used Power BI Desktop, it's the PBIX file format. When they say analytical reports, we're talking about Excel. And when they say mobile reports, they're referring to what used to be called DataZen, but it's the new mobile reporting feature in SSRS. Power BI reports themselves are inherently mobile. They render within the Power BI mobile client. And in fact, the Power BI mobile client is used to render these SSRS-style mobile reports. But to get into, just to round it out, the Power BI service itself doesn't do the classic reports. It does do the interactive, of course. It renders analytical reports, Excel, of course. And it doesn't render those native SSRS mobile reports. But as I was saying, its reports are natively mobile. So let's look at a couple of demos. Can we switch over to this machine now?
I'm going to deal with the backgrounds.
Yeah, that'll be good. Okay, so I want to start here, and what I want to do is connect to our secret shopper data, which is stored in SQL Server on-prem, but I want to have that published in the Power BI service. And I also want to take that file and put it in Office 365 for people to consume, but I need it connected to my live data. So to do that, I've got Excel running. I'm going to come up to the Data tab, and I'm going to hit New Query. I'm then going to come down here, say, From Database, from the SQL Server database. And what this is Power Query. It's not labeled as such in the tab in Excel 2016, but that's what it is. So this server is Steam-SQL. There's the name of the server, and the name of the database is inspections. So I'm making a direct connection right now from this workstation on-prem to the SQL server that's also on-prem. I hope.
There we go.
You got the background fixed?
Yeah.
Background's fixed, folks. Okay, and so immediately it says I need to be authenticated. I'm just going to go ahead and use my current credentials. I'd like to, okay. And it's not authenticating with a user. Do you remember what the SA password is?
Let me.
For SP 2016?
I think so.
I swear this stage is cursed, folks. SP admin.
Let's try SP admin. This feels better.
I only ran through this about six times already today.
Well, seven's a lucky number, so.
If it doesn't work, I'll talk you through it. It's fine. Okay, so we're good. All right. So we're no. All right. So
let's proceed on.
I'm gonna I have an example already in here. So for just such an occasion, if we pop over here to PowerApps. So what I'll describe what happens. Basically, all I need to do in that case is make that connection to the backend database and create. Just a little pivot table, simple pivot table that you'll see if we come over to our SharePoint site. And documents, okay, let's go. So in our documents library, we have an analysis folder. So I would have created that pivot table and saved it off into this analysis folder. If we open up the workbook here, you can see it renders in Excel online, just through Office 365. This is exactly what you would expect. And we can slice and dice on this pivot table. And you can see all of the data is there. However, if we just go ahead and do that, just save that Excel workbook out into Office 365, we will not be able to refresh it. If we come over here and hit the data refresh button, it won't refresh. What we need to do, if we want to keep it up to date, is pop over to Power BI. And in Power BI, I'll walk through the process. I've already attached this file. But if we go into the Get Data section, go into the Files area, and I'm in a group. I should have pointed that out already. So I'm in a group workspace in Power BI, so it knows I'm in the Field Research SharePoint group. I'm going to click on my OneDrive, although I can pick any SharePoint library I want. I can open up Analyses, click on ESPC Demo, and hit Connect. I want to get to this point because I want to distinguish between these two different options. When I connect Excel data in Power BI, I can either import it, and that essentially converts it to a native file, Power BI file format. Or I can connect to it in place. And that's like working with it in SharePoint. We actually use Excel online to render. But when I make that connection, or as soon as I make that connection, I have the ability to come over here and hit Schedule Refresh. And when I do that, you'll see I have this option to use a gateway connection. We can say here, use a data gateway. There's the data gateway Chris was describing just a few minutes ago. And when I do that, I don't even have to use Power BI anymore. If I open it up, this is the native Excel online that I had just opened. If I come over here and use my data button, I can just simply refresh all connections, and it's going to go out for me and get the updated data. And I can also update it, working on it. Nobody's ever seen this error message before. Not error message, but message. But I can also come over here to Power BI anytime I want and just say refresh now. So I can do it on demand, but I can also schedule my data refresh. In this case, it's scheduled to update once per day, but I can schedule it to update at least up to eight times per day. Sorry. All right, that's one scenario. Another scenario, and I'm not going to go through it because you already saw it in the secret shopper report, but I could take Power BI and do a direct connection back to that data and deploy that out. And that's what you saw here in the secret shopper report. Actually, there's one more thing I want to show you from the ESPC demo. When I've got the Excel workbook open here in Power BI, I can just highlight a number of cells, and I could say, that's interesting, I'd like to have them on my dashboard. Come over here, hit the pin button. It's saying, where would I like to pin it to? I'm going to pin it to an existing dashboard, my ESPC dashboard. Or actually, I'm going to pin it to home in this case, just so you can see it, because it was blank to start with. And when I do that, I come up here to my Power BI home dashboard, and we can see we've got this Excel, just this little piece of the Excel workbook we were looking at. And that'll be updated whenever the data gets refreshed. Okay? So that's one way to get Excel data up there. If we have our secret shopper report, there might be an element from that that we want to include up on the dashboard as well. Let's just say this little wheel that shows how much more work Chris has been doing than I have. So I'm going to simply hit the pin button on that and do the same thing. I'm going to put that on my existing dashboard, pick my home, pin, and you'll see that show up here as well. Okay? So we can mix and match data from different types of reports in different areas in Power BI.
So, John.
Yes.
If you've done that.
Yes.
And I am on a mobile device.
Yes.
And I want to consume that on Power BI, I have to be able to directly get back to the source SQL environment to read that report element pinned to Power BI, don't I?
Of course you don't have to do that.
Right.
Yeah, you can use the Power BI mobile. And if you pin this, if you pin the reports, the underlying reports, as you saw with Chris's demo earlier, you can do it with the SharePoint app, or you can use the Power BI app to just interact with all of this stuff. So the data may be direct back on premises, but because it's done securely, you can just pin back and run the reports. And importantly, if you're using direct query, your data does not live in the service at all. It meets any sort of data sovereignty requirements of keeping the data on premises completely. One other way to get that on-prem sort of data is through SSRS. And I'm running SQL Server Reporting Services 2016. I should pop back to browse. This is the new management interface in SSRS 2016. It's a lot prettier. SSRS got a major facelift in 2016. But one of the new features it received, I'm going to run this reports by reporter report, and it's connecting again to that same inspections database. And I've got this little visual that shows what Chris has been looking at and what I have been looking at. But I want that on my dashboard as well. So keep in mind, SSRS is a purely on-premises product. There is no cloud version of SSRS. So this guy's running on-prem. But I can still come up here and click on this Power BI icon. And then I basically ask, which visual would I like to include on the dashboard? Well, I'm just going to click this one. I have the option of putting it on my native Power BI workspace, but we were working in the field research group, so I'm going to click on that, and then I'm going to choose which dashboard. Again, I'm going to choose my home dashboard. I'm going to say I'd like my updates to my dashboard to happen daily. I can do it every hour if I want to, or I can do it weekly. I'm just going to leave it at daily. I'm going to go ahead and say pin. I'm going to close that. And now when I pop back to Power BI, we should see that visual just show up right within our dashboard. Pretty cool, huh? That's cool. Come on. Thanks a bunch. And I think we want to pop back over to the slides for just a moment.
Let's go.
Are you
ready? Slide.
All right.
Okay.
And the
clickers. Take a look.
Yeah. Yes! So sorry. Except you're a section ahead. We just want to pop back. Yeah. Let's go back.
Okay.
I just want to walk through exactly now. We're hurting on time, aren't we?
Not hurting.
We're okay? Okay. So the way it works, what we saw there before, I created an Excel workbook. Well, I tried to. I take connecting from Excel directly to my SQL Server on-prem. I then took that Excel workbook and saved it into a SharePoint library. In our case, a group library, but it doesn't matter. I could then use Excel Online to view it. When I connected Power BI to it, I was then able to work with the Power BI service and also use the data management or the on-prem data gateway to keep that data refreshed, completing the cycle. Okay? I think it's important to understand how these things work. We can kind of see what the different permutations are. When I pinned that Power BI report to it, the way that Power BI was, report was put together, it was, I started Power BI Desktop. I connected again to the same on-prem server, so I did this on-premises. I then deployed that report straight out to Power BI, where I could access it from a mobile client or from a browser, and then Power BI directly comes back to that on-prem data gateway. It just takes the Excel piece out of the loop. I actually, if you're wondering what Power BI Desktop is all about versus what Excel is all about, one way I like to think of it is, if you took Excel with all the Power add-ins, right, Power Query, Power View, and you just deployed that and you took Excel away, that's what Power BI Desktop is all about. And then finally, with SSRS, we have this reporting server that's running on-prem. It's directly connected up to SQL Server, but on demand, I was able to push that tile up into the desktop and then access that with a browser. And the SSRS itself, the agent process on SQL Server that's running SSRS, is able to keep that data up to date, so I don't have to do anything to refresh it. We already saw the SharePoint web part, so we're not going to bother. Nope. We're not going to bother getting into that. Now we want to turn around and look at some on-premises visuals, so basically rendered in SSRS or Excel, but using some cloud-based data. And again, I talked about the four different report types beforehand. If you look at what SSRS can do, Excel Online, the online server on-premises, can render these analytical reports. And SSRS itself can do these paginated reports. Doesn't do interactive yet. Doesn't do analytical yet. And it does do those mobile reports. And I say yet for a reason. You can imagine what that is. So let's have a look at a couple of those things. So can we pop over to the demos? Yeah, thanks. OK, great. I have another report in here. It's tyGraph. tyGraph is my company's product, and we deploy tyGraph. One of the ways we deploy tyGraph is through a content pack in Power BI. And when you hydrate this content pack, what it does is it reaches in through a series of APIs and puts data in the data model. But it's really just there for reporting. Now, we've got what we think to be a fairly comprehensive set of reports out of the gate. By the way, what we report on is Yammer data. We have a fairly comprehensive set of reports out of the gate, but there may be cases where we didn't anticipate your needs, but the data is in our data model. So what I want to do is take Excel on-premises, but query my data from the data model. And the way you can do that is through a Power BI feature called Analyze in Excel. So you're looking at the tyGraph screen. If I come down here to the data source that's behind it, I can just click on this ellipsis. And I have this option here for Analyze in Excel. Now here's what's interesting. It downloads, if you see down here, we're using Chrome, so we get the little downloader in the bottom left. We get this ODC file. And if you've worked with data before in Excel, you know exactly what that is, Office Data Connection. I'm just going to go ahead and enable it because there's a security. This is coming from outside your organization. And I immediately have access to the complete data model that's in behind this content pack. So if I say, for example, wanted to see metrics at the top, so I'm going to scroll down here. I'm going to find messages, my messages metric. There we go. Number of messages by user. And member name, sorry. Oops. Bam, we just get to see that right off the bat. We can, of course, sort, et cetera, maybe throw in a slicer, one other thing. And I could slice on, date would be a good one, but I'm just going to use group name, groups and group name. So just like that, just like this, this is our actual corporate data, so I get nervous. but I could start slicing and dicing on these different groups, and I'm analyzing data that's sitting in the Power BI service live. Okay? That's one way to go about things. Also using Excel, I'm going to create a new one. Have you ever had an occasion where you'd like to look at the data in a SharePoint list, but analyze it? Right? Fairly frequent requirement. It's never really been easy. It's kind of simple to do now. Again, we're going to leverage the power of Power Query. I'm going to come up here to Data, and I'm going to come down here and say New Query from an online service. So I'm going to go out to a SharePoint online list, again on-prem. and I'm going to punch in the URL. To get the URL, I'm just going to come over here. I'm going to come over here to our field research. So what I want to do is get at that SharePoint list data before it hits SQL Server. And I'm going to come over here and get the URL for our field research site that we've been using for demos. And then come back. Come on, there we go. Punch that URL, okay. And I'm asked to authenticate. Let's hope it works this time. We're not currently signed in, so we're prompted to sign in. This is where I'm really glad we're not using two-factor.
Yep.
And I'm signed in. I can go ahead and connect now. And what we get is a complete list of all of the lists in that SharePoint site. I'm interested in the field reports, and you can see there they all are. I want to do some editing here. So I'm going to go ahead and hit the edit button. And what I'm doing is making changes to that extract, transform, and load process. And you get everything about the list back by default. I don't need it all. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to select a few of these columns. I'm going to get rid of them. And I'm going to come over here, get rid of a bunch more. And these are the system columns in your SharePoint list. I'm going to get rid of these guys. And then finally, I'm going to get rid of everything to the right of this. But I want to come back and show you a couple of peculiarities about working with a SharePoint list.
You have 8 minutes to show the peculiarities.
I have 8 minutes? That's way more than enough time. Or is that 8 minutes left in the session?
8 minutes left in the session.
Okay, we're going to hurry. You can see here our product, the product name that we're after, it just shows up as a number because that was a lookup list in SharePoint. At least we don't get that hashtag and have to parse all of that stuff out. And we also have this comments column here that's basically HTML. It's got these divs in it, et cetera, et cetera. So what I'm going to do is just come over here to this column called field values as text, and I'm just going to expand this out, turn this off. Turn off select all columns. What field values as text gives you, I'm going to pick comments and product. If I can find product. What that lets you do when I open that up is it's going to go out and get the textual representation of the underlying data. So if you've ever tried to retrieve data out of a SharePoint list, you've probably bumped into this for any of these rich data types, lookup columns, managed metadata columns, et cetera. Well, this comes in here. And it just figures out how to get that rendered out properly for you. So I can now do the analysis with a pivot table, et cetera, without having to worry about create additional tables and join them, et cetera, et cetera. In the interest of time, I'm going to cut this short. You can imagine I can just simply save this off and put this in SharePoint and work with it. All right, but that was the important part of that demonstration. Okay, so if we could flip back. And then quickly, I'm going to walk through how that was put together, yep. Or what that consisted of. So in the first case, we have we had the tyGraph service. That's a cloud-based service. And the Power BI goes out and gets the data for me, puts it in the model. We all are able to consume it. But I'm also able to connect to it with Excel and pull that data down and do custom analyses. In the second case, we're able to connect directly to SharePoint with Excel. I didn't bother going out and deploying it, but we could put that out into SharePoint and then start to interact with the data model I'd created in Excel as well. And again, use Power BI update, or sorry, what we can't do if we deploy it to an on-premises version of SharePoint is keep it up to date, because right now, Power Pivot for SharePoint, which is what we would use, does not support Power Query. It will in the near future, it doesn't to date. However, if we were to deploy that to SharePoint online, we would be able to. And we won't. I'm not going to bother showing the SSR. But no. what I wanted to show you at this point, Kant, is the fact that SSRS is in preview with the ability to render Power BI reports right within the SSRS service. So for everybody who's wanted to say, who has said, I like Power BI, but I can't use anything in the cloud, this will solve that for you. You will be able to create these high fidelity reports, get them deployed out to SSRS on premises without ever touching the service, without needing an account, and use Power BI capabilities.
Okay, so we have a couple minutes left. One of the lovely advantages of being able to present with a partner is the ability to watch the things like the Twitter stream while we're talking about it. So as we wrap up, I really wanted to make a couple of points really clear. For SharePoint solutions for business apps today, we love Power Apps and Flow. One of the things that I really was looking forward to being able to share with the audiences at Ignite is what we see the role of Power Apps and Flow as. They are the tools for doing business applications in SharePoint today and tomorrow. When we think about business applications in SharePoint, we recognize that there are some long-lived investments in some other tooling, as well as some other new things that are out there. So I really want to distinguish where we see Power Apps, Flow, and Power BI fitting into this tool set. InfoPath and SharePoint Designer are tools that we extended the support model for earlier this year. Solutions based on InfoPath and SharePoint Designer, we've extended support for those products as if we had issued new versions of them when we released SharePoint Server 2016 in the spring. We recognize that business transformation, digital transformation, takes a long time for many organizations to shift from old modalities to new. That's part of why we wanted to give a very long runway to let you take those solutions off. But we want to make it crystal clear, we view Power Apps as the successor to InfoPath for the classic scenario of custom forms on top of SharePoint lists. We view Flow as the successor to the classic automation of processes that people were doing inside Designer. Now, Power Apps and Flow today don't do everything that the older tools do. They do many things that the older tools never would do. We're continuing to invest in the integration and the extension of those moving forward. And there are some other tools that are out there that are being introduced for specialty purposes. Some things like that we've done with things like Access Web Apps, some things that we've done with Microsoft Forms, which is a new quiz and survey tool. Those are very much distinguished. We really want to make this clear so there's no question is that where we are putting a big bet is around Power Apps and Flow for modern, mobile, web-based business applications that integrate data from SharePoint, data from SQL, from other cloud sources, and being able to light them up beautifully with many of the visualizations that John and I have been showing you here today. So I keep hitting the back button instead of the forward button. Some of the things that have already been announced or are currently in preview, the Power BI SharePoint Online web part, that we are showing today. There's a couple of security dependencies that we're still waiting to wrap up. We look forward to releasing that into SharePoint Online over the next 2 or 3 months, as we disclosed in our blog post 2 weeks ago. That's out there, the next major step is taking something else out of preview, which is Power BI being able to render inside SSRS. What does that mean? Well, if you're running reporting services on premises, we want you to be able to take those Power BI elements and add them into SSRS in parallel with the process we've seen for taking SSRS and injecting it into Power BI. So that is something that is also currently in preview. You can play with that to your heart's content by downloading that. There's a VM that's available inside Azure right now. And the last major piece of that is going to be able to take Power BI elements and embed them into SharePoint on premises. That is also coming. It's dependent on the framework, are getting us rolled out into SharePoint 2016. And beyond that, since the modern web parts that we're rolling out, our client-side web parts will provide patterns and practices for adapting those into classic SharePoint 2013 environments as well. So as we're wrapping up, one of the key things to keep in mind is the on-premises data gateway is the key to rolling out hybrid business intelligence, hybrid business application solutions that bridge the gulf between on-premises and cloud. Cloud BI, the platform of choice, is going to be Power BI. On-premises, the platform of choice is going to be SQL Server reporting services, and SharePoint's role is to be able to weave all of that together with the long-standing legacy of information that lives inside of documents, inside of lists, inside of custom pages, and who you are matters. All of these tools are based on the idea that your connections are your connections. We set up pathways, but the behavior of these tools, we recognize security is essential, and it's important to make sure that you have the right identity foundation around all of that. So we're going to have time for a question or two here before we have to officially wrap this up. So
they asked us to just have anybody line up at the mics.
Right, so if you have a question, if you could make your way to one of the microphones, we'll take a couple of questions here in the general session, and then John and I will be down in front to answer any questions we're unable to answer here. So anyone?
We've got one gentleman here.
Yep. Yep.
Sorry to ask this.
Yes.
Will
all this work with the German cloud? Yes, it's our intention to do it. The German cloud, we govern the German cloud similarly to how we govern what we call the other sovereign clouds, such as the Gallatin cloud, which runs in China, or the two Gov clouds that we run within North America for civilian and secure access. So it's coming. It's going to take us a little bit longer because we have some extra compliance levels there, but absolutely, that's going to be available there. I want to say in about 3 months. Sure. Other questions?
So, if the link doesn't, if at diverdown 1964, hit me with that and the hashtag. I will tweet a new one as well.
Okay.
So it might be the name change or something that's done it to us. But you can also, by the way, get this deck at. Through the MyESPC application. This is meant to be a convenience. But please do that. I'll tweet out a new link.
One or two more questions, and then we'll kind of break. Could you?
Question about designer
and I couldn't hear
that
question.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me repeat the question. The question, for example, is if I've built a process in SharePoint Designer, what is the model for how that comes into flow? Well, if you have a designer workflow that's tied to a list, if I build a flow that's doing things to that list that trigger a condition, that designer workflow is still going to be effective simultaneously. So a flow and a classic workflow can live simultaneously, which can be good or bad based on what you're building the process to do. In similar fashion, if you have data that is built, if you have stitched InfoPath to run inside of a browser form against data that lives in a list, and then I come along and I build a Power App to replicate that information, that Power App is going to be able to take over as a default view, replacing the default views that you had out there for that were sourced by InfoPath. One of the things that we previewed at Ignite, that again is based on some of the same security technology around the Power BI web parts, is the ability to embed a Power Apps form directly inside the browser. Right now, if I'm in browser and I'm on a custom list and I want to launch a Power Apps form, it's going to launch in another tab or another window, which is okay, but we want it to all stay within the confines of SharePoint. We have that in preview right now. That's coming in about a month or two. Beyond that, you're then going to be able to take that form and embed it anywhere you want. So you don't necessarily even have to go to the list view to take the form for the list view and put it right in the homepage of your team site if that's what makes sense in your scenario. Any other questions, folks at the mics? Or okay, sorry, it's hard to see with the light, but... Yes.
So I've got a client who wants a custom form in about 4 or 5 weeks. So I've kind of got to do it in InfoPath, I find. Or is there enough in Power Apps?
Is there enough in PowerApps? What I can tell you about PowerApps is it is in general availability. So my answer in October and September was, if you want to be in the bleeding edge, recognize you're on a preview product. It's not a preview product right now, so you can feel comfortable if the functions that it offers are sufficient. The reason why I talk about that classic forms on SharePoint list scenario is InfoPath is not really a forms designer. Do we all know this? It really isn't. It's an XML document manager. And it got stitched into SharePoint 10 years ago and sort of became this default designer as sort of a Frankenstein monster and okay, oh, and let's throw in a C-sharp code behind page just for good measure and let's see what people can do with it. And people did a lot of things with it. Taking that over, what?
So, and you're from Microsoft.
So what I will say is Power Apps has all that mobility, all that, those connection services that may be exactly what you're looking for. If what you're looking for is XML document access, if you're looking for some of those structured repeating blocks, if you're looking to take documents offline, synchronize them, make changes there, and when the user comes back in, have them be automatically synchronized to a form library instead of a list, those are capabilities that are not in Power Apps today. They're definitely being designed and studied, but based on which one of those two scenarios sounds more like was really how I would guide you toward the solution. And I'd be happy to talk to you at the break about more details. So we're out of time. We know that we are standing between folks and getting ready for the big gala event at the Palace tonight. So John, thank you very much.
Thank you, man.
And thank everyone here, and we'll be sticking around.